Right. So, let me present to you Prof Batch, who is a Barbarian hacker and Haskell developer.
I hope you had a good nutritioning phase. We're going to talk about the power to revolutionize Nix packages. And of course, I'm talking about testing, right? Because we're all doing it, it's great, everything's automated, and we don't have any breakage ever on master. Right? Okay, no, probably not. So what do we have right now? We have basically two sets of tests in Nix packages at the moment. The first is in lib test, and it's testing, like the path says, it's testing the library. We have a lot of library functions, which are basically, because Nix is not a general purpose language, we don't have as much as other languages, but we have quite a few, and we do unit tests for them. Not very many, but I'd say it's okay. And the functions are very simple. You can run them via Nix build, lib test release.nix. And there's a second test set, which probably many of you know, which is the VM tests. These are quite impressive. If you don't know about them, they are basically, you give a module, you give like your system config for one or more machines, and then you say, oh, here's a Perl script which maybe waits for the machine and then connects to the other machine, runs a service and checks for the result and then says, okay, or nah. And yeah, and those are pretty fast. You can start one in 2 to 3 seconds and the tests run for a few seconds and then you have a complete test. For those of you who don't know, the Quake test, which has two machines, a client and a server. The server runs Quake in server mode, starts the map, spawns a few bots, waits for the player, the client machine, to join, waits until the client is fragged, and then makes a nice little screenshot, and that is then put into the out path, as far as I know. Maybe I could be wrong, and it could not even exist anymore. Those two sets, they share a problem, or they have a few problems that they share. Lib/tests, okay, it's maybe better than the NixOS VM tests, which are in /NixOS/tests, and then there's a whole lot of files, but the real modules are spread throughout the NixOS subtree. So the tests at the moment are pretty far removed from the implementation. Which, when you are writing a module and or fixing a module, you might not even know that there is a test. You might not know how to run the test, or you might change the module and submit something, someone merges it, and the tests fail, and nobody has any idea where they failed, what failed. Maybe one or two maintainers know about it. That leads to the second problem. They run separately. So when you change the module, you have to start the test separately. And you have to run them manually. And all of these three problems basically lead to the synchronization of the tests and the modules. No tests being written for modules because nobody knows how to write them or nobody knows that they even exist. And bit rot of the tests, especially in the library functions, where you can change a library function or add a new one and not and then test fail, and yeah. Of course, good CI could fix that problem or mitigate that problem, and good tools could, like the bots that Graham proposed in the last talk, but maybe you can do better. And I thought about the problem a bit, and I came up with two maxims. Like, what should always be ensured when you write tests or when you write testing systems? And the first one I came up with is the test should be as close as possible to their implementation. If possible, in the same file, maybe right under the implementation, at least in the same directory, very near, where you can always, when you open the folder, you see, oh, test dot. Like when Golang does one thing very right, and that is every file has a test file right beneath it, right in the same folder, and you can't miss the tests. And second thing that is not done very often, it should not be possible to change the implementation without running the tests. And it should not be possible to even run the implementation without first passing the tests, which might sound a little bit far-fetched, but bear with me, because it actually exists and it works right now. For example, if you are in allpackages.nix and you have the well-known hello world package, new hello, the default package, and you want to test if it works without running it manually. Right now the call looks like this. You have a call to call package and it instantiates the package. I left a little hole in there because it should not even be possible to assign hello without running the tests first. So we should run some tests in between before it gets assigned. And of course, we don't want to recompile hello when some test changes because you added a test or something. So that's pretty much basic stuff. So the hello derivation, which is the right part, it depends on the successful build of the left part, so the hello assignment depends on the successful build of the hello derivation and some tests, whatever they may be, and however they get run. But the derivation mustn't depend on some tests, because if something depends on something else, you all know it, it will be rebuilt by Nix. We know such a function. Maybe there is a function in Nix which does basically that. It runs the left side and it returns the right side when the left side is evaluated. Yeah, trace. It's implemented by which function? Yeah, it's a built-in function. It has three letters. Sec, right. If you come from Haskell, you know that function. When you're in a functional setting, you sometimes want to have dependent order of evaluation, and then you use sec, which sequential maybe comes from sequential, I think. And it evaluates, it evaluates the first argument before the second and then returns the second. So maybe we can just input it into sec and it will work. Let's try calling sec with a new simple derivation which just writes text to the file blah and then returns hello and we get hello. Okay, that seems fine. And then let's try it with the file foo. We change the left one to foo, and oh, crap. We get the same hello, but the tests have changed, so maybe it should be a different hello. Or maybe, we can see that hello clearly hasn't depended on the test. So we are very sad. So could it be that there is a built-in that's evaluating the derivation first and then returning a second one? Maybe. No. So we even sadder now. But maybe we can do something about this. And so it happened that one fateful night last year, Aslik and I were sitting in our hackerspace like two chairs apart, and it was very loud and people were doing stuff, and I had my screen on the presenter and was basically doing a pair programming session with Aslik over the noise of the hackerspace. We were shouting between each other, and I said, maybe we can implement something like that, so then we can improve testing. It would be very much like sec, so we should call it derivation sec. And it has two arguments. The left one is evaluated, the right one is returned. So the left one should be our test, and the right one should be the left one should be our test, and the right one should be our output derivation. So the idea that we had was maybe we can create a new derivation that is exactly like the output derivation, but that runs the tests. So what should we do? We should first collect the outputs that exist of that alt derivation. Then we assign them to the outputs of our new derivation. We get all the attributes which are in deriv out address and add them to pass through, so they get passed through to the new derivation and they will be inside as the derivation attributes of our new derivation. And now we still don't have the tests anywhere, so what do you do when you want to depend on something inside a derivation? You just pass it as an argument and it gets passed to the bash builder or the builder script and everything's fine with the world. So now we have a new derivation that clearly depends on our test. Of course, now we have all the metro attributes in place, but there's still the file left. So we thought a bit about that and just tried following. I took our alt outputs and mapped over each output a bash script. I did some shell escaping. I resolved the link so that it points to a real file or directory, and then we symlinked it into the next store, and it worked. Aslik didn't think it would work, but now we had a complete copy of the old derivation, and basically the devsec function now works as intended. We can expand it to a list. A functional programmer would maybe think now we have a little for a single element function, and now we just fold over the single element function and the list, and that creates a lot of symlinks that we don't want. So the pragmatic programmer just turns it around, and the list version is the primitive, and the one element call is now the devsec function. And we are at the moment, and now we can implement our test function, and which takes an attribute set of tests, which are shell scripts with names, the red one, and the output, in this case hello, puts something into devsec l, which is a list of tests, and then the original output. Each test will be put like plain text into a script. Out is touched so that the build doesn't fail. If the script didn't fail, the build will not fail. And yeah, basic run command stuff. And we've got a test. To see that this works, Sekai konnichiwa, hello world, hello Welt. We use the new hello program. We change the derivation a little bit. So we put the original make derivation inside a let, assign it to the name hello. I reset my timer. Okay. And call with tests, with our new test. So what could we test for GNU Hello? Do you have any ideas? Maybe. What's the most basic thing you can test for a binary? It runs and does not crash, right? How would you test GNU Hello that it runs? Which is kind of simple, is just execute it and check the exit status. Or if you're really fancy, you even check, like you grab hello world and yeah. And that's like a test script. And in a business world, you would call this an integration test for hello world, which is quite fancy. we could go a little bit further and check the version output. And you can depend on nix values, which you previously defined in your let binding. So we can now test if the hello world really is the hello world that it says it is, or at least the developer didn't forget to change the version string, which already happened with some Python packages. And when you run that, you don't run it, you just say nix build minus a hello. You can see it's building the hello test, which gets KDL, then it's building the version test, which gets VND, which are just shell scripts that are then put into our new hello and run. As you can see, it first outputs hello world and then the version number. Those are grepped, so if the grep doesn't work, it will exit one and the test will fail, and you get a new hello. Right. Yay. This doesn't stop there, because that's just bash script executing, which you can do manually. But you now have the full power of Nix at your disposal to bring revolution to testing. If you look at the old, you can see the duplication. There's bin hello twice, and then you grep twice. And so why not just capture it, refactor into a function, function match standard out, which has an invocation and a regex, and will have a nice error message if the regex doesn't work, and capture the bin hello part. And now the tests look like this. Just two normal Nix functions with a bit of string interpolation. What if we want to grab for goodbye sad world instead? This will happen. Hello test will try to get built. We get our nice error message from our helper function. Output did not match. It was goodbye cruel world. It should have been hello world. No, the other way around. It should have been goodbye cruel world. It was hello world. And the builder for the test fails. And as you can see, the other test doesn't get rebuilt, and hello doesn't get rebuilt as well. Right. So that's basically the idea behind Nix package testing. Package testing, not VM testing, you just need Nix build process. I tried a few things, like what can you do with that, how can you integrate tests inside normal derivations, and the first thing was to eat my own dog food. So we now have the testing functions. Why not test the testing function? For that, I quickly noticed that I needed to actually run Nix inside the Nix build to generate the output of the test, so I can grab the output of the Nix run. So I thought, well, that's it. I cannot go any further. Then I grabbed a little bit inside Nix packages, and inside lib/tests, they already have something like that to run the Nix invocation. Right? So I factored it out into a shell script, and then I started testing the shell script first, because who knows if it is wrong or if it works or doesn't work. So let's test that script. Like run Nix instantiate on a simple derivation, then use that derivation, run Nix build on that output, and look if and see if it outputs what the derivation build script said it should output, and grep for that. And now we have guarantees that the Nix invocation actually works, like that Nix actually does what it should do. So we basically did an integration test for Nix. Sorry, I don't have scripts for that, outputs for that. But yeah. Step 5, that's a horrible joke. Nobody here understands, and I'm sorry for the two people that do. Another idea was, you have like Beats, which is a music tagger, and I could run Beats in a test and do version checks. It's actually really nice for Python packages. because maybe a lot of you know that Python, if it builds, it doesn't mean it actually runs. Like most Python binaries just stop with an import error in the first line. So we could actually now test every Python binary, for example, for a version string, and automatically get guarantees for the whole Python set. I don't have it in this presentation, but what you can do is use the build Python function, get in the argument, insert the with test function, and do a nice call, and then you can actually test functions for every input they get. And for every input that is different, it will run a different test. For example, a Python package. That could be done. It actually works. No idea if we want that, but this is a nice thing that only happens in Nix because you have a short evaluation phase. And yeah. So if you have that music tagger beats, we can actually go a little bit further and call a different version of beats inside our tests. And since we assign it above, the three dots after beats are the implementation of beats, then we have the full package with override capabilities, and we can override that full package inside the tests, like enable a plugin we want to test, which is not enabled by default. That's one way. Yeah. Another proposal I have, which goes towards the VM tests. Right now, as I said, the VM tests are very much in a different folder than the actual modules. So why don't we just integrate the tests inside our modules? Keeping the first maxim I defined earlier, keep tests close to implementation. These VM tests are at the moment run by Hydra. There's a list of tests which Hydra runs, and it's basically an attribute set which is nested in arbitrary deep nestings with packages at the leaves. So if we could add arbitrary nested attribute sets to the module system, then we can just add the tests attribute. Right. Then inside each module, you can set the test attribute to like your foo test, which is a derivation which runs a VM test. And in Hydra, where's the Hydra part? Yeah, and in Hydra, it basically gets a config set and calls it config set. Don't know why it's missing. And this is like a different testing approach than before. So I left the package tests. Right, you can define the type which takes like address off or list off, and the second attribute like int, bool, whatever. And then you can say, our test is a nested attribute of a nested type of attribute sets of packages. And yeah, that will do what you want, and you will get a nice list of tests for Hydra. So I'm still actively working on this and have been for the last year or so on and off. And I want to hack on this at the hackathon on Monday and Tuesday. First, the with test interface might get changed a bit, like having shell scripts might not be the best interface for a generic interface. We should implement a few tests for packages which are a bit more complicated than Hello World. Then we should do a pull request with the primitives and the example packages. Yeah. Normal stuff. Before I go, I have two more things I'm working on. I'm working on a tag union type for the type system. For those of you who miss the some type way of doing type definitions, you can now do something like that, which is like my hard drive has a power management value and it goes from 0 to 8 bits and the 0 is off and 255 is something and 200 and the first half is some value and the second half is some value and now we can do off or low from the low values and or high from the high values and you specify that and yeah, that gets type checked. And I have a little project which does enumerators, small check like enumerators for NICS values, also with the module system to test changes in the module system. Right.
All right, that's fast.
Great idea. For the package tests, where would you put the actual tests? Because, for example, in the Hello World example, in the old packages, we have the Hello World attribute.
Yeah.
I guess you won't put it there, right? Because that would, then it would the old packages would become too big.
In the old, so I had the example earlier, right? Over here. I started with in the first example I had something like
call package hello world and then
tests equals empty space call package and we don't want to put the tests here because that's why I in the actual example here why I put this inside hello default button.
Oh hello okay I missed that yeah.
So we define the package in a lab binding and then use that for the test. So we have this in the same file, which is as close as you can get.
So how does this work with depending on tested packages? Since the output path changes each time, wouldn't that result? So if you add a test to some library, wouldn't all the packages depending on that library need to get rebuilt, even though the library itself is still the same?
If you test the library and add a test, yeah, that would probably happen.
So yeah, but that's not something you...
That's always a problem if you have the tree and if you change something in the tree, which is transitively depending, where executables are depending.
Yeah.
You will. So you probably have to... Still, you have to create a leaf, which then has the library. Or you can, test the library and rebuild once, and then test for everything that goes through that library. Yeah.
Yeah, interesting talk. Thank you. One thing that I would like to mention is that even though I find it fascinating, I also find it somewhat scary, to be honest, because integration tests in general tend to be a maintenance nightmare. Mm-hmm. And so anyone who has ever done or maintained integration tests for a non-trivial project maybe experienced that at some point. So in the end, if you have some non-trivial program, and Hello obviously is a trivial one, and you have someone going overboard with tests, like that funny little Quake example. And then at some point in your super elaborate tests, which is like a couple of hundred of lines of bash code or whatever, something somehow goes wrong because maybe some sort of semantics of the tool changed, and the package that you're testing might still be entirely okay, but now you have to, you have to not only maintain your program, but also your elaborate tests. And I find that prospect actually scary because in the end, you update something, maybe you want to do a drive-by contribution and upload the version, and then something somewhere changes and you have no idea why and what. And so I find that scary.
So I think that's mostly a problem of testing the wrong things. The only thing you want to test is things you have you absolutely want to be true. Not things you think that might be true, or things that you think that might be true that are true at the moment because the test passes, which is a bad thing to do. But guarantees you want your packages to give, like, does not crash with an import error for every Python executable, thank you very much. And the second part was, I lost it. That's probably the main problem with implementing that is making sure the error messages fit the tests, that you don't get any empty lines when something crashes. And that's also a problem of getting good testing library support, where you have a testing library which has basic building blocks, which then give good error messages.
Oh, I just wanted to respond to that also. Like, it sounded like, I almost feel like characterizing it as integration tests is sort of blowing it out of proportion. I mean, these packages have tests of their own. So what we're actually testing is like a sanity smoke test type thing of like, does this thing crash at startup? Like, those are his examples. Like, if these things become complex, I think we're doing it wrong.
The integration thing was mainly a joke.
Yeah.
And to trigger some people, and I succeeded. Yeah, if it's a good program, it will always behave the same for the same inputs.
Why don't we just write a test derivation besides package derivation and let Nox review build tests? This way we avoid rebuilding packages that depend on our package when the tests change.
Do we mean libraries or?
Well, you described how to wrap a package with a dummy package with some links it outputs. What if we don't wrap the package with a test package, but add the tests package? For example, ENO packages.
Ah, right. You mean there is already a test phase inside our make derivation standard env right now. The problem with that is these are good for tests that come from upstream. Like if you have a library which does tests, unit tests, and they get run, and if they don't, and if they fail, this is an upstream problem. But if we add integration tests, we don't want to add them to the check phase because then after our build, the build will fail and we have to restart the whole build.
Well, I don't mean the check phase. I mean that what if we add another derivation, another package in, for example, in the old packages?
And you mean like another leaf, like another executable, which then gets collected and tested in?
No. I want to exploit the fact that Nox review rebuild. I'm not sure. I wanted to rely on a Nox review to run the tests. This way, we don't have to force Nix to run the tests every time we build a package.
Maybe that wasn't clear from the example. When I run this, and when I run it the second time, it will always be a single operation because I don't have to rebuild the tests.
Yes.
As with other derivations.
I think what he wants to say is, why don't we like just add a like a pass-through attribute which doesn't change the derivation.
The derivation. Yeah.
Which isn't picked up actually while building, but only like with an extra tool that specifically runs the test.
That could be done, yes.
That would like fix the rebuild case.
It violates the thing I wanted to guarantee. So it's as always, there's two. Yep. Whatever your use case is, and if it's higher up in the tree, then you have to be very careful what you change. And if you add a space to a standard and bash script, you will trigger mass rebuild. You have to be very careful with testing as well. So the higher up in the tree it is, the more conservative the tests have to be. And if it's like a Python script nobody cares about, then just bash the tests. Bash the tests. Okay. Yeah. Or intentional stores, right?
All right, thank you.
And maybe if Elko doesn't like this thing, I we could maybe add it as a built-in deref sec. Yeah. Right.
Thank you.